Good morning, everybody. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today, we will discuss one of the most important topics in cardiology and one of the most sophisticated and most difficult one in diagnosis and management, which is the cardiac involvement of autoimmune disease. As you all know, that autoimmune disease affect people in their most productive stage of life, and these diseases are very disabling. For example, rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus, scleroderma, and other diseases, they are very disabling. They usually affect joints and affect multiple systems in the body, and the outcome is very bad for these patients. Outcome in their lifestyle or in their medical status. And so early detection of these complications of these autoimmune disease is critical, while permanent damage to other organ can still be avoided. The increased risk of cardiovascular problems and mortality in autoimmune disease usually is due to interaction of multiple factors, as inflammation, which is the common base for either atherosclerosis and autoimmune disease, also the metabolic factors that arise with the autoimmune disease and the treatment with steroids that affect the metabolic profile of the patient, and there are other disease related factors from the disability and the stress and the psychological impact of these diseases on the individual. To illustrate the magnitude of the problem, in this cohort study that include 900,000 patients that studied the association between chronic immune-mediated inflammatory disease and the cardiovascular risk. Here we can see that we are comparing a lot of diseases according or regarding the coronary artery disease, cardiovascular disease, and stroke, all-cause mortality. Coronary artery disease is specific, and cardiovascular diseases in general. And we compared inflammatory bowel disorders, rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, non-inflammatory diseases, inflammatory polyarthropathies, and systemic connective tissue disease, and spondyloarthropathies. We can appreciate that most of these inflammatory and autoimmune conditions, when compared to the non-inflammatory disease, shows that most of them have more coronary artery disease, more cardiovascular disease in general, more stroke, and more all-cause mortality. We can appreciate that this is the non-inflammatory disease. This curve is for non-inflammatory disease. We can appreciate that patient with non-inflammatory disease has a better survival than other auto-inflammatory and autoimmune diseases. And here also, we can appreciate that the non-inflammatory is better, is to some extent better than most of other diseases. And here also in coronary artery disease and stroke. So we can conclude that most of the auto-inflammatory disease and autoimmune diseases has bad outcome compared to non-inflammatory diseases. Significant proportion of these patients which have autoimmune disease develop cardiovascular complication, and I can say that 50% of the SLE patients, systemic lupus erythematosus, develop cardiovascular complication with significant morbidity and mortality. And the most common cause of mortality in systemic lupus erythematosus and rheumatoid arthritis is cardiovascular complications. The poor scientific knowledge, late recognition of the complications, under diagnosis or under treatment of cardiac involvement is the main causes of bad outcome in these patients. So the primary prevention of these diseases is the key priority for the public health agenda. Our agenda today will include three main items. We will discuss firstly basics of microbiology and immunology. We will discuss what is immunity and what is autoimmunity, because this is the pathogenesis of most of the diseases that we will talk about. And we will see what is the autoimmune disease classification. We will give short notes on each, and we will talk on the cardiovascular complications for all. And finally, we will talk about general scheme for management of these patients. Firstly, with the basics of microbiology, immunity, and autoimmunity. From the basics of microbiology, we can start with the information that we have two different, in general, we have two different types of antigens, foreign antigens or self-antigens. Self-antigens means the antigens of our bodies, which is called autoantigens. While foreign antigens is not related to our own body, and it is not part of the human body, and it is mostly it is of non-human nature. We have different lines of defense. We have a first line of defense, which include skin, mucous membranes. Second line, defensive cells, the macrophages, antimicrobial substances that are produced from the antigen-presenting cells and the macrophages, inflammation, fever. This is the second line of defense. But the third line and the main line of defense in our body and the immunity is the T and the B cell lymphocytes. T and the B cell lymphocytes should know our own antigens. Our immune system generates lymphocytes, clones that can virtually recognize any antigen in the universe, including our autoantigens, our own cells and the molecules. And the very important role of the immune system is to control the tendency of the B and the T cell lymphocytes to invade our own antigens and or immune and invade our own cells and autoantigens. The lymphocytes having receptor against self-antigens are constantly being generated in our body. And these lymphocytes, either B or T, that can recognize our autoantigens is called the self-reactive lymphocytes. And the immune system must control these autoreactive lymphocytes. Otherwise, these lymphocytes will attack our own bodies and cause autoimmune diseases. So the state of unresponsiveness of the immune system to the antigens is called the immune tolerance in general. While the state of unresponsiveness to the immune system to our self-antigens, our autoantigens, is called self-tolerance. And this is the main mechanism. The self-tolerance is the main mechanism that prevent the autoreactive T and B lymphocytes from invading our tissue and causing autoimmune diseases. If this self-tolerance fails and the autoreactive T and the B lymphocytes start responding to the self-antigens, it will cause the autoimmunity and the immune system will attack ourselves. And this is the pathogenesis of autoimmune disease. Individual own molecules, cells, tissues, organs are damaged as a result of immune system attack. We have two main mechanisms of tolerance, which is called the central tolerance and the peripheral tolerance. The central tolerance means it is the primary or central lymphoid organs where the development of the lymphocytes take place. It includes the thymus and the bone marrow, in which the T and the B lymphocyte first express antigen receptors. And in this process, which is called the central tolerance, the thymus and the bone marrow control the autoreactive T lymphocytes. Again, the T and the B lymphocytes that is called the autoreactive, these cells can identify our self antigens, auto antigens, and they can invade them. So in this process and in this stage, the thymus and the bone marrow control these autoreactive cells either by damaging it or by making it non-responsive, as we will see the mechanisms of central tolerance. And we have a second line of peripheral tolerance. If the autoreactive cells could escape the central tolerance, it will find another second line of peripheral tolerance, which it is present in the peripheral lymphoid organs as the spleen and the lymph nodes, where the immune system can prevent the lymphocytes from attacking our body and prevent the autoreactive cells from being released into the our tissues. And as we just said, that the peripheral tolerance organs include the spleen and lymph nodes. Peripheral refer to secondary or peripheral lymphoid organs. Lymphocyte response to foreign antigens are initiated or developed. Lymphocytes responses to foreign antigens are initiated or developed. What is we have for T lymphocytes, central and the peripheral tolerance, and for B lymphocyte, central and the peripheral tolerance. Here, the central T lymphocyte tolerance in the central organs, thymus and the bone marrow. The precursors of T cells migrate from the bone marrow to the thymus. And these immature T cells, remember again, we have T and B lymphocytes that carry antigens, that carry antibodies for the whole antigens in the universe, including our own autoantigens and the foreign antigens. So the fate of immature T cells is decided by the strength of the interaction between T cells and the T cell receptors and self-peptides. This means that in these two organs, the immune system make a test for the immature T cell and test it for its reaction with our self-peptide or self-measure histocompatibility molecule. And the response of the T cell will be one of three responses. Either no interaction, and in this condition, the immune system activate the apoptosis of these cells. Or very strong interaction, and in this also, the immune system damage and induce apoptosis of these T lymphocytes because they are autoreactive. If these T lymphocytes, which have very strong interaction, are released into the circulation, it will cause autoimmune disease. So the response of the immune system is to kill these T lymphocytes, which this is called the negative selection. And if there is no interaction of the T lymphocytes with our cells, it's called the non-selection. While the only T lymphocytes which are allowed to go to the systemic circulation, who have moderate interaction with the self-peptide, self-measure histocompatibility molecule. And this is called the positive selection. So, in the process of central T cell tolerance, we have three responses. The only T cells that are allowed to go for the systemic circulation is the cells that have moderate interaction with our self-peptides And this process is called the positive selection. While if one or more of the O2 reactive T lymphocytes allowed to escape the central tolerance, it will find another peripheral tolerance, as we said, in the spleen and lymph nodes with a different mechanisms. A lot of mechanisms can the immune system control these cells by them. Peripheral clonal deletion, energy, immune deviation, immune privilege, immune suppressive cytokines, and regulatory T cells. We will not go deep in all these mechanisms, but we will talk briefly on peripheral clonal deletion and energy. As you see that T cell activation by the dendritic cell is one of the antigen presenting cell, which is present in the second line of defense in our immune system. It can identify foreign antigens and presenting them to the T lymphocyte. So the T cell activation by the dendritic cell includes three signals. Signal 1, peptide measure histocompatibility and the T cell receptor interaction here. This will allow the signal 2 to start its co-stimulation by B7CD29, and this will allow the signal 3 to happen, which is cytokines that facilitate the activation of the T lymphocyte to start for their action and for their defense mechanism against the foreign antigens. This is the normal T cell activation. While the autoreactive T cells, again, the cells that can identify our own antigens, are eliminated by programmed cell death and apoptosis. And it does not go in the three signal steps of the normal T cell activation. So these autoreactive T cells, if the dendritic cells present self-antigen to the T cell and started to react to these our self-antigen, the immune system will consider this as autoreactive T cell and inhibit the other two signals, and this T cell will go for apoptosis. And this is called the peripheral clonal deletion of T lymphocytes. Some of the autoreactive T cells can survive but remain inactivated. And this is called the energy. The energy means that this autoreactive T cell can survive and avoid the apoptosis but remain inactivated, which is called the energy mechanism, as we said just in the previous slide. Peripheral clonal deletion and energy. And all these mechanisms are mechanisms for peripheral tolerance of the T lymphocyte. On the other hand, B lymphocyte also has two mechanisms, either central or peripheral. The central B cell tolerance, which is happens in the thymus and in the bone marrow, can happen by also two mechanisms, either clonal deletion or energy. Energy or clonal deletion. Clonal deletion, most of the or all B cells that can react with our self-antigens is called the autoreactive or self-reactive cells. By mechanism called receptor editing. Receptor editing, change in the receptor of these B lymphocytes, will make these B lymphocytes is supposed to be to make these B lymphocytes is not reactive to our own antigens. If it is still self-reactive, we the immune system do another receptor editing. If after a lot of receptor editing the B lymphocytes still autoreactive and still can recognize our self-antigens strongly, these cells go for apoptosis, and this is called the clonal deletion, receptor editing clonal deletion. On the other hand, the B lymphocytes, the autoreactive B lymphocytes, can be presented and can the monovalent antigens can be presented to these O2 lymphocytes. This action, if the B lymphocytes can react with the self antigens, the immune system may make these B lymphocytes unresponsive, which is called also the anergy. In general, B cell activation needs a T dependent activation in three signals. This is the normal T dependent B cell activation. The B cell activation firstly interact antigen recognition and the binding to the T helper cell. Signal 2, interaction between CD14 and CD14L. Signal 3, releases cytokines that help for the activation of the B cell. If one of the autoreactive beta B lymphocytes escape the central tolerance, it will find the peripheral tolerance. The main mechanism for the peripheral B cell tolerance is the anergy. What is energy again? The immune system can detect the autoreactive B cells that can react to our self antigens. In the absence of signal 2 and signal 3 of the normal beta cell activation, these autoreactive cells become unresponsive, which is called anergy. So the immune system can detect the autoreactive B cells in the peripheral tolerance and inhibit their activation in signal 2 and signal 3, and this makes them unresponsive, which is called anergy. Again, central B cell tolerance and peripheral. The peripheral is the energy, while the central B tolerance is the clonal deletion. Clonal deletion for the self-reactive B lymphocytes after receptor editing. After receptor editing and multiple trials of receptor editing, if the receptors of the B lymphocytes can react with our self-antigens after several trials, this B cells is called the self-reactive, may go either for apoptosis or for to become unresponsive in the energy process. So after this illustration of the immune tolerance and the control of the B and T lymphocytes, we can say that most of the autoimmune disease have different predisposing factors, which include infections in the presence of genetic factors and the genetic susceptibility of the patient that lead to failure of tolerance and finally lead to the autoimmune disease. So the pathogenesis of most of autoimmune diseases is composed of multiple combinations of these three factors: infections, genetic factors, and failure of tolerance. It is thought that susceptibility genes and the environmental triggers induce the number of changes that contribute to the development of autoimmunity, and these changes include defective tolerance and regulation, abnormal display of self-antigens, inflammation, or initial innate immune response. All these changes can happen, and they can be the triggers for the autoimmunity. What is the role of infection? Infections can induce abnormal immune response and finally lead to autoimmune disease. And we have a lot of examples in cardiovascular medicine. For example, rheumatoid and rheumatic fever. Rheumatic fever is an autoimmune response to antigen produced by bacteria, which is group A beta hemolytic streptococci, that cause infection, and the abnormal response of our immune system to the antigen produced by these cells will lead to the autoimmune disease or the autoinflammatory disease or the inflammatory disease, which is the rheumatic fever, in which the bacteria has gone but left its effect on our own tissues. The immune complexes that are directed to the these bacteria are directed to the self antigens, which is the endocardium of the heart muscle, causing a lot of valvular affections. The autoimmune reactions may be triggered by infections, and the two mechanisms have been postulated: induction of co-stimulators on antigen presenting cells, or molecular mimicry. Molecular mimicry is the typical example of this. Molecular mimicry is the rheumatic fever. Induction of co-stimulator and antigen-presenting cells, as we will see now. This microbe is presented to the antigen-presenting cells that make these cells to present our self-antigens to the T lymphocyte. In the presence of co-stimulatory molecules, these T lymphocytes will invade our tissues, causing autoimmunity. So this is one of the mechanisms of autoimmune reactions, and the role of infection in induction of autoimmune reactions. The other mechanism is the molecular mimicry. Microbe go to the antigen-presenting cell. Antigen-presenting cell, there is a molecular mimicry between this microbe and our own antigens, activates the T lymphocyte, and the T lymphocyte will go for our self antigens, which is similar to the microbe antigens, and they are similar in their structure, and finally causing autoimmunity. The microbes may induce other abnormalities that promote autoimmune reactions. Some viruses, such as the Epstein-Barr virus, HIV, can cause polyclonal B cell activation, which may result in production of autoantibodies. The tissue injury that's common in infections may release self-antigens. When the T lymphocytes invade our own tissues, this will destruct the tissues and release self-antigens that are structurally alter the antigens so that they are able to activate the T cells. And these abnormally released antigens have a different, can stimulate the T cells that would not be tolerant again to these new modified antigens that can activate the T lymphocyte to invade our own tissues. In the presence of genetic susceptibility and the failure of tolerance to the self-reactive lymphocytes, and in the presence of environmental stimuli, infections, tissue injury, inflammation, this may activate the antigen-presenting cell and the T lymphocytes that invade our autoimmune, own cells, and cause finally tissue injury and autoimmune disease. General features of autoimmune disease: they are chronic, sometimes we relapse and remissions, and the damage is often progressive. The systemic diseases tend to involve blood vessels and connective tissue, and therefore they are called the collagen vascular disease or connective tissue disease. And this is for our first item in this lecture. We talked about the basic microbiology. We understood the immunity and the autoimmunity, which is the base to go for the clinical side of the lecture, which is the autoimmune disease classification and the cardiovascular complication of each. And first of all, there is a very nice article which is published in 2017 in the European Heart Journal, which is talking about the diagnosis and the management of myocardial involvement in systemic autoimmune mediated disease, which can provide the structure of the management of the diagnosis and the management of a lot of these different autoimmune and autoinflammatory diseases. One of the most important ideas and rules that must be that must we take our own that we must take our own a check for them is this is systemic inflammatory diseases. I would like to say the autoimmune the boundaries between the autoimmune disease and the autoinflammatory disease. This is one of the most important concepts that must be looked for. Autoimmune disease and autoinflammatory disease have a common background, but with different pathogenesis. And we have a lot of diseases. We have a lot of diseases that have a combination between autoinflammation and autoimmune nature. And these diseases range from these rare monogenic autoimmune diseases, classic polygenic autoimmune diseases, organ non-specific, as the rheumatoid, primary biliary cirrhosis, myasthenia gravis, dermatomyositis, scleroderma, and etc., systemic lupus. Some of the mixed pattern disease acquired the component and the autoinflammatory component. Polygenic autoinflammatory disease. A lot of diseases include Crohn's, sarcoidosis, and psoriasis, and rare monogenic autoinflammatory diseases. The mean monogenic or polygenic means that have a lot, polygenic means a lot of genetic factors or multiple genetic theories or multiple genetic theories. For example, if we have genetic factors, stability genes, and environmental factors and infections, this is called the polygenetic factors. Monogenetic usually is related to one of these multiple theories, either genetic causes or environmental or infections and etc. In our lecture we will talk about mainly about the autoimmune diseases. Our lecture is autoimmune diseases and the cardiac involvement of autoimmune diseases. So I would like to make your attention that we have a lot of other autoinflammatory diseases that also may have cardiac involvement. But in our lecture, we will talk about the autoimmune diseases. In another classification of other of the autoimmune diseases, we can classify them into organ-specific or systemic diseases. And to further reclassify these items, the organ-specific can be mediated. Diseases can be mediated by antibodies, mediated by mediators of T lymphocytes, or diseases postulated to be autoimmune. For example, the diseases that mediated by antibodies: myasthenia gravis, Graves' disease, Gross' pasture, atrophic gastritis, pernicious anemia. While the diseases mediated by antibodies, which has a systemic nature, is systemic lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, systemic sclerosis, Sjögren, is systemic autoimmune diseases, which is mediated by T lymphocyte. And this is for example. So we can classify the autoimmune diseases into two classifications, either organ specific or systemic, and each of them can be reclassified according to the mediating autoimmune profile, either antibodies or T lymphocytes. When we talk about the cardiovascular affection of the autoimmune disease, we have a spectrum that we are talking about. Most of these autoimmune diseases affect the cardiovascular system in different parts. What I mean that most of these autoimmune diseases can affect all layers of the heart, including the endocardium, valvular, the myocardium, causing myocardial disease, or the pericardium, causing pericardial effusion and pericarditis. And also, as a part of the cardiovascular system, it can affect the vascular system. Vasculitis, thromboses, arterial stiffness, atherosclerosis, and can cause electrical abnormalities. So these autoimmune diseases can cause sudden cardiac death, ventricular arrhythmias, SVTs, EV block. So this is the spectrum of cardiovascular affection of the autoimmune diseases. This is how the autoimmune diseases and what is the magnitude of affection of these autoimmune diseases for the cardiovascular system, as we say that we have valvular, myocardial, pericardial, vascular, and electrical affections. We will talk firstly about the systemic lupus erythematosus, which is the prototype of the autoimmune diseases. The systemic lupus erythematosus have a different criteria, and to diagnose the systemic lupus, we should have four criteria of all these criteria in one patient at one time. We will go rapidly through these features. And as I said before, that the cardiologist should be aware of the manifestations of these autoimmune diseases, because many of these patients will present to him. So he should identify these patients to probably manage them in a multidisciplinary team. Firstly, the malar rash. The malar rash is a fixed erythema, flat or raised over the malar eminences, tending to spare the nasolabial fold. And this picture, we can say this is the nasolabial fold. It is spared here, and the malar rash affects the cheeks in, as we see. Second thing is the discoid rash, which is erythematous raised patches with adherent keratotic scaling and follicular blocking, with atrophic scarring, which may occur in older lesions. As this is a scaly lesions, this is a discoid rash. The photosensitivity, which is a rash as a result of unusual reaction to the sunlight by patient history of physician observation, and this is the picture of photosensitivity. We can say that the area exposed to the sun is showing affection, while the other areas of the skin is free. Oral ulcers or nasopharyngeal ulceration, arthritis, which is usually non-erosive, involving two or more peripheral joints, tenderness, swelling, effusion. This is in contrast to ankylosing spondylitis, where the arthritis there is erosive, but the systemic lupus is non-erosive arthritis. Serositis include pleuritis, pericarditis, peritonitis, renal disorders resistant to proteinuria, and the presence of casts in the urine. Neurological disorder, the presence of seizures or psychosis, but in the absence of offending drugs or metabolic derangement, like uremia, ketoacidosis, electrolyte imbalance, that can mean seizures. So to diagnose the seizures, that is one of the diagnostic criteria for systemic lupus, it must be diagnosed in the absence of other metabolic derangements. Hematological disorders include the hemolytic anemia, leukopenia, lymphopenia, thrombocytopenia in at least two occasions, and in the absence of offending drugs. Immunological disorders and antibodies, this is the lab part or the immunological part of the systemic lupus. anti-DNA antibody to native DNA or abnormal titer, anti-SMS antibody, and the positive finding of antiphospholipid antibodies based on an abnormal serum level of IgG or IgM anticardiolipin antibodies, or positive test for lupus anticoagulant using a standard test, and false positive serological test for syphilis, known to be positive for at least 6 months, and in the absence of treponema pallidum infection. So, if you have IgG, IgM, anticardiolipin, and lupus anticoagulant, or if you have positive test for syphilis in the absence of syphilitic infection, so all these criteria can be considered an immunological disorder that help in the diagnosis of systemic lupus erythematosus. The presence of antinuclear antibody in general, an abnormal titer of antinuclear antibody by immunofluorescence, as we will see, or an equivalent assay at any point in time, and in the absence of drugs known to be associated with drug-induced lupus syndrome, is considered one of the criteria to diagnose systemic lupus. So, to diagnose systemic lupus erythematosus, we should have four criteria of this scheme. And as we said before, this is the malar rash, excluding the nasolabial fold, and this is the discoid rash, and this is photosensitivity. We can see the affection in the areas exposed to the sun, and this is oral ulcers, and all of them are very important criteria to diagnose systemic lupus. Systemic lupus is the prototype of the autoimmune diseases, and we will talk in depth make him as an example for the following autoimmune diseases. In the presence of susceptibility genes, this may activate B and T lymphocytes, which may be autoreactive. The presence of external or environmental factors as an ultraviolet radiation, this may make the cells to go for apoptosis, and this the defect in the clearance of these apoptotic bodies may induce this B and T autoreactive B and T lymphocytes that will produce antigen or antibodies. These antibodies will react with our self antigens, and finally they will reduce, and finally the beta cell will be activated to plasma cells that produce O2 antibodies against our own cells. This is the pathogenesis of how systemic lupus erythematosus happens. If we talk specifically on anti-nuclear antibodies, they are antibodies directed against the nuclear antigens, and they can be grouped into four categories: either DNA in the nucleus, or histones, or non-histone proteins, or antibodies against nucleolar antigens, not nuclear. This is nuclear antigens, and this is nucleolar antigens. And the most widely used method for detecting these antibodies is indirect immunofluorescence, as we will see now. And the pattern of nuclear fluorescence will suggest the type of antibody present in the patient's serum, and finally will suggest a disease or group of diseases. For example, this is the immunofluorescence of the cells of a systemic lupus patient. We can say the homogeneous diffuse staining of the nuclei. So usually this, when we see this pattern, homogeneous pattern, this usually reflect antibodies to chromatin or histones, and occasionally double-stranded DNA, and this is the most common in systemic lupus erythematosus. This is the most common pattern of immunofluorescence to in systemic lupus erythematosus. When we go for another pattern, speckled pattern, observed in most of the autoimmune diseases, so it is the least specific. It can be present in multiple autoimmune diseases. reflect the presence of antibodies to non-DNA nuclear constituents such as Smith antigen or ribonucleoproteins or B-reactive antigens. So it is the least specific. It's called speckled. As we can see, it is it show a lot of speckles. In contrast to, this is a homogeneous or diffuse staining. This is the speckled pattern. The centromeric pattern, which is pattern staining of anti-centromeric antibodies, is seen in some cases of systemic sclerosis and Sjögren syndrome. This pattern further illustrates that the antibodies is directed to the anti-centromeric or centromeric molecules in the nucleus. Nucleolar pattern refer to the presence of few discrete spots of immunofluorescence within the nucleus and represent antibodies to RNA. So finally, I'd like to say that this immunofluorescence pattern can suggest the nature of the autoimmune disease that we are facing. So it is important to use this maneuver to in the diagnosis and the management of these patients. These fluorescence patterns are not absolutely specific for the type of antibody, as many autoantibodies are present and the combinations are frequent. Nevertheless, this staining pattern is considered of diagnostic value and the test remain in use. Antibodies to double-stranded DNA and so-called Smith antigens are virtually diagnostic of SLE, as we just said in the criteria for diagnosis of anti-DNA double-stranded or anti-Smith are diagnostic for SLE. Moving to another very important point, we have a lot of cardiovascular drugs or drugs that are used in the cardiovascular diseases that can induce lupus, as ibuprofen, quinidine, and hydralazine. Ibuprofen and quinidine are class 1A antiarrhythmic drugs, and the hydralazine is direct vasodilator. These drugs can induce lupus-like manifestations, as we just said. They can alter the autoimmunity state, and they can alter the tolerance, and they can, in the presence of susceptibility genes and environmental factors, they can induce lupus-like manifestations. So we should take care of patients taking this medication, as they can develop lupus-like manifestations. When we will go in most of the autoimmune diseases, we will talk about myocardial, pericardial, endocardial, vascular, and electrical affection in order to memorize the spectrum of the affections of autoimmune disease. So when we are talking about the myocardial affection in the systemic lupus erythematosus, we will talk about lupus myocarditis. Lupus myocarditis is uncommon and be reported in less than 25% of the clinical series of SLE. The risk is increased in patients with peripheral skeletal myositis, when the peripheral skeletal myositis is associated with systemic lupus erythematosus or included in, the risk of lupus myocarditis is increased and usually associated with systemic vasculitis. And symptomatic myocarditis with signs of congestive heart failure is quite rare through myocardial involvement. Reduction of left ventricular ejection fraction, diastolic dysfunction, left ventricular hypertrophy can be subtle and detected only when we do non-invasive testing for SLE. So we recommend that in patient with SLE, if we have any doubts that the patient have any myocardial affection, signs and symptoms of manifestations, dyspnea, or exercise intolerance, we should go for echo, as the echo may show us that this patient have myocarditis and affection of the myocardial function. we may find reduction of the LV ejection fraction, or may find diastolic dysfunction or hypertrophy. Hypertrophy, left ventricular hypertrophy from the edema that's present in lupus microglia. According to the position paper, just we said in the beginning of the lecture, which is present in the European Heart Journal, according to the recommendations for the SLE, endomyocardial biopsy, applying the histology and the immunohistology and the PCR for detection of infectious agents, may be useful for diagnosis of SLE myocarditis, since the SLE patients are at high risk of infection due to the disease itself and due to the immunosuppressive treatment. Going to the pericardial affection in systemic lupus, the pericarditis is the most common problem. It can appear at any point during the disease course. It may be complicated by lupus-related renal failure. The lupus can cause renal failure, and renal failure can cause pericarditis and the pericardial effusion. Usually it is exudative with increased protein, decreased glucose, and may cause tamponade, may go for constrictive pericarditis. Regarding the endocardium, valvular involvement is common in SLE. And what is the abnormalities that can we see in SLE? It may affect the valves, causing valvular thickening. It may cause non-infectious vegetations, which is called the Lehmann sac endocarditis. Usually, it is present on the atrial side of the mitral valve and the arterial side of the aortic valve. It may resolve or worsen over time. It may affect the valvular function, causing valve regurgitation, or if it is large, it can occlude the valve and cause valve stenosis, or may embolize. So the affection of these vegetations may be valvular regurgitation, may be valvular stenosis, may be systemic embolization. And this is a live picture for the Lehmann sac endocarditis in the atrial side of the mitral valve. Going to the vascular component or vascular affection of systemic lupus, we can have pulmonary hypertension caused by the thromboembolism related to antiphospholipid syndrome, which we talk about later on. Or it may be related to intimal proliferation of pulmonary vessels, or may be related to vasospasm, or may be related to pulmonary arthritis. So the presence of pulmonary hypertension with SLE has a lot of vasogenesis, either thromboembolism, either intimal proliferation, either pulmonary vasospasm, either pulmonary arthritis. Also in the vascular component, we can have aortitis. We can have ischemic heart disease and the premature atherosclerosis. It's most common cause to cause ischemic heart disease in the systemic lupus patient. We have coronary arthritis, coronary thrombosis. If it is associated with antiphospholipid syndrome, we have coronary embolism, thrombosis, arthritis, atherosclerosis. This is the affection of the systemic lupus to the coronaries. And finally, the electrical affection of the systemic lupus, it can cause sinus tachycardia, atrial fibrillation as a part of a myocarditis. It may cause supraventricular arrhythmias during the lupus flares. It can cause sinus bradycardia, prolonged QT. Take care that most of the SLE patients are treated with hydroxychloroquine, which is a disease modifying drug that have a very famous affection for the QT, which can prolong the QT and can induce ventricular arrhythmias. Very important point regarding still the electrical affection of SLE, that infant of mothers with SLE or other systemic autoimmune diseases may have increased incidence of congenital heart block. And this is related directly to the presence of anti-Ro and anti-La antibodies in this patient. the maternal anti-Ro and anti-La antibodies can be transferred to the uterus, go to the baby, cause inflammation and the fibrosis of the conduction system of the baby, and cause heart block. The risk is low in general in women with SLE and the pregnant woman with SLE, but women with such a disorder should be screened for these antibodies before pregnancy, as the heart block onset usually occur in the first trimester and almost it is irreversible. If recognized early in utero, dexamethasone may reverse the condition, but if not recognized early, it may cause complete heart block, which is irreversible. So we can recommend that any patient with SLE and she want to become pregnant, she must be screened for anti-Ro and anti-La antibodies. If they are present, she should be counseled that they may have a baby with complete heart block. And if she insisted on pregnancy, we should monitor the presence of this complication, which is complete heart block, to the baby. And we can give her dexamethasone to reverse the condition if it happened in the first trimester. Regarding the rheumatoid arthritis, it is one of the commonest forms of the chronic inflammatory polyarthritis. It's characterized by chronic symmetrical polyarthritis, joint destruction and deformation, and this is called erosive arthritis. In contrast to the systemic lupus, is usually causing non-erosive arthritis. It typically affects the small joints of the hand, metacarbophalangeal and proximal and interphalangeal joints, wrists and knees. And usually it spares the thoracolumbar spine and the distal interphalangeal joints. The thoracolumbar spine is usually involved in the spondyloarthropathies, as we will see later on. Rheumatoid arthritis affects 1-3% of the whole population, so it is very common, more common in females in contrast to males. And the cardiovascular disease is the most common cause of death in rheumatoid arthritis. Regarding the myocardial affection of rheumatoid arthritis, it can cause myocardial rheumatoid nodules that can cause cardiomyopathy. It can cause secondary amyloidosis. This patient may have secondary amyloidosis, which may cause cardiomyopathy. Regarding the pericardial affection, as we just said in the SLE, it can affect 50% of the patient. The presentation may be acute pericarditis, constrictive pericarditis, or chronic asymptomatic effusion. The pericardial fluid, usually blood tinged, with high leukocyte count and low glucose level compared with serum glucose. Regarding the endocardial affection of rheumatoid arthritis, valvulitis that may end in mitral regurgitation or rarely stenosis. Regarding the vascular affection, rheumatoid arthritis can cause aortitis, pulmonary hypertension from the rheumatoid lung disease and the interstitial lung disease. It may cause coronary artery disease because it increases the atherosclerotic coronary artery disease risk of due to the chronic inflammatory state, steroid treatment, which accelerates the atherosclerosis, methotrexate treatment, which is integral part in the drugs used in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. The methotrexate increases the homocysteine level, which will increase the atherosclerotic coronary artery disease risk. Also, one of the mechanisms that the rheumatoid arthritis affects the vascular system and cause coronary artery disease is coronary arthritis. So finally, rheumatoid arthritis can cause aortitis, can cause pulmonary hypertension, can cause coronary artery disease, either atherosclerotic or arthritis. If the patient of rheumatoid arthritis develops secondary amyloidosis, this may cause heart block. And since it's a rheumatoid arthritis patient, this is one of the recommendations of the task force for these systemic autoinflammatory and autoimmune diseases. Since it's a rheumatoid arthritis patient, they have a high burden of cardiovascular disease, mainly because of accelerated atherosclerosis. Multidisciplinary management, including cardiologist, is indicated and should be driven by clinical suspicion from attending physician. Going to the seronegative spondyloarthropathies, this is a group of disorders characterized by involvement of the spine, sacroiliac joints, inflammation of tendons, ligaments, their insertion point into bones, which is called enthesicytes. It's common in contrast to the rheumatoid arthritis and the SLE, it's more common in males than in females. And these conditions include four conditions. All of them is called seronegative spondyloarthropathies. Ankylosing spondylitis, ankylosis and sacroiliitis, asymmetrical peripheral arthritis, post-infectious reactive arthritis, including Reiter syndrome, patient may have UTI and then developed arthritis. This is Reiter syndrome, characterized by conjunctivitis, genital ulcers, asymmetrical peripheral arthritis. Psoriatic arthritis, which is present with psoriasis, inflammatory bowel disease associated arthritis. Many of these patients have HLA-B27 gene, and this is further emphasize the theory of multigenetic and the polygenic nature of this autoimmune disease, that the presence of genetic factors in the presence of environmental factors and or infections can all induce autoimmune diseases. So most or many of the patients that have seronegative spondyloarthropathies have HLA-B27 gene, which may permit abnormal immune response to gut or mucosal bacterial antigens that cross-react with the tissue antigen present in his joint, skin, and other tissues that will lead to manifestations. We can see here the advanced ankylosing spondylitis that happens to the spine. Regarding the endocardial affection of spondyloarthropathies, we may have aortic root disease, aortic root dilatation, aortic regurgitation. We may have proximal aortitis with aortic regurgitation, conduction disturbances, especially with ankylosing spondylitis and Reiter syndrome. Subaortic bump with ankylosing spondylitis, which may make aortic valve or mitral valve thickening with nodularis. The electrical affection of spondyloarthropathies may the spondyloarthropathies can cause inflammation that extend to the subaortic area, leading to heart block, usually at the level of the AV node. Going further into the antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. Antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, it's a clinical syndrome characterized by presence of either antiphospholipid antibody or lupus anticoagulant, plus otherwise unexplained recurrent venous or arterial thrombosis or recurrent miscarriages. To diagnose antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, you should have both of these criteria, the presence of antibodies and this form of thrombosis or miscarriages. The causes and types of antiphospholipid syndrome, it may be secondary in the presence of SLE or other autoimmune diseases or infections, or it may be primary in the absence of other autoimmune diseases. We have a third type of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, which is called the catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. Catastrophic characterized the rapid onset thrombosis, disseminated the small vessel thrombosis, and the multiple organ dysfunction. Systemic inflammatory response syndrome with acute respiratory distress, which may lead to ERDS. This is an aggressive form of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. So we have three clinical types: secondary, primary, catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. And the diagnosis should include the two criteria. The pathogenesis is very important to can in order to illustrate the clinical picture. The antiphospholipid antibody syndrome and the lupus anticoagulants are directed against the phospholipid binding protein, not against the phospholipid itself. As you know, that proteins are more antigenic than the phospholipid. So the anticoagulants and our antibodies are directed against the phospholipid component of the phospholipid binding proteins, not the not the phospholipid itself. And this include beta 2 glycoprotein, prothrombin, and annexin V, protein C, and protein S, tissue factor pathway inhibitor. And as you see that the antibodies that are directed to tissue factor pathway inhibitor will lead to coagulation, protein C and protein S, and interfere with their action will lead to coagulation and thrombosis, because they are natural anticoagulants. So if they are not working, this will lead to thrombosis. And annexin V, which is the natural anticoagulant, which is present in the placenta and the vascular endothelium, when the annexin 5 is not working because of the antibodies, this will cause placental vascular thrombosis and will lead to miscarriage and abortions. So two mechanisms may explain thrombosis of antiphospholipid and lupus anticoagulant: interfering with the phospholipid dependent anticoagulant pathway, which we have just telling it, the activated protein C, tissue factor pathway inhibitors. They are natural anticoagulants. When they are not working, this will lead to thrombosis. Or the other mechanism that may explain the thrombosis is binding to cell surfaces, and this will activate the cells and induce thrombosis. The endocardial affection of the antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, it may include thickening of the heart valves and vegetations, causing thrombotic non-bacterial endocarditis, or it may form intracardiac thrombi. So the affection, it may form intracardiac thrombi, or it may cause thickening vegetation, thrombotic masses, which can be named as non-bacterial endocarditis. The vascular affection of antiphospholipid syndrome include three main items: venous thromboembolic disease in the legs and lungs, arterial thrombosis may lead to stroke, thrombotic coronary artery disease, pulmonary hypertension, which may arise from the venous thromboembolism, it may lead to chronic thromboembolism and CTPH, or it may be due to pulmonary arterial intimal proliferation, not thrombosis. So we have different mechanisms for development of pulmonary hypertension in antiphospholipid syndrome: either chronic thromboembolism or pulmonary arterial intimal proliferation. The venous thrombosis and arterial thrombosis are in the picture of the antiphospholipid syndrome. One of the most important information that the cardiologist should know about the antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, that this patient in their management will need anticoagulation for life. Which is best, warfarin or NOAC? This TRAPS study is a randomized controlled trial of the NOAC versus warfarin in antiphospholipid antibody syndrome in patient with high risk patient with lupus anticoagulant positive and anticardiolipin positive and beta 2 glycoprotein positive. They are classified or randomized into two groups. The patient will take warfarin or take rivaroxaban. And the study was stopped prematurely because of excess events in the arm of rivaroxaban. So, as a conclusion, when the antiphospholipid antibody syndrome patient need anticoagulation, they should go for warfarin only. And the NOACs are out of speak in these patients. Polymyositis and dermatomyositis is a form of idiopathic inflammatory myopathies characterized by proximal skeletal muscle weakness, as we can see, and the increase in muscle enzymes as a creatine kinase and aldolase. This is the polymyositis. The dermatomyositis, in addition to this myositis, have a skin involvement. Skin involvement, erythematous scales on the knuckles, which is called the Gottron papules, and the knees and the elbows. These lesions are present in either knuckles, elbows, and knees. And the periorbital swelling and the violaceous rash around the eyelid, which is called hilo or trop rash. So, dermatomyositis include manifestations of polymyositis plus skin involvement. Collectively, the dermatomyositis and the polymyositis can cause myocardial dysfunction with clinical heart failure, conduction defects, pericarditis, pulmonary hypertension, secondary to interstitial lung disease, or coronary arthritis with ischemic heart disease. When polymyositis and dermatomyositis are part of other overlap syndrome. In autoimmune diseases, we may have systemic lupus erythematosus features alone, or rheumatoid arthritis alone, or sarcoidosis alone, or we may have as an overlap syndrome patient, which may have clinical picture of all these diseases, which is called which can be collected in a clinical syndrome called mixed connective tissue disease syndrome. So, if the dermatomyositis and the polymyositis are part of this overlap syndrome, usually this will be associated with coronary arthritis and ischemic heart disease. Graves' disease, as we all know, that it's an autoimmune disease in which thyroid is overactive, producing an excessive amount of thyroid hormones, as we see. And these thyroid autoantibodies activate the TSH receptor, thereby stimulating thyroid hormone synthesis and secretion, which will not respond to the negative feedback control. This is the normal response. Pituitary secrete TSH, stimulate the thyroid cells to secrete thyroid hormones that will go with negative feedback on the pituitary gland. So this is the homeostasis. But in the Graves' disease, there is an autoantibody to the receptors of the TSH that stimulate the thyroid hormones secretion without any negative feedback on the pituitary. Or if it is caused the negative feedback in the pituitary, the TSH will be decreased markedly, but the secretion of the thyroid hormones will continue and continue due to the presence of autoantibodies. As we all know, that the Graves' disease has a lot with thyrotoxicosis, have a lot of cardiovascular manifestations, includes exertional dyspnea because of the respiratory muscle weakness and the palpitation of increased heart rate and contractility. And by inspection, we can see the hyperactive pericardium, loud cardiac sounds, associated sound SS3 murmurs, which is mid-systolic due to hyperdynamic circulation. And the complication of the Graves' disease can include atrial fibrillation, hypertension, systolic and maybe diastolic, pulmonary hypertension with increased cardiac output. In the absence of pulmonary vasodilatation, this will cause pulmonary hypertension. These patients have high cardiac output symptoms and high cardiac output status. In the absence of pulmonary vasodilatation, this will elevate the pulmonary systolic pressure, unlike vasodilatation response of systemic circulation. This patient, Graves' disease, have vasodilatation response of systemic circulation, but have no pulmonary vasodilatation So, if the cardiac output increased in the absence of pulmonary vasodilation, this will cause pulmonary hypertension. So, one of the implications that TSH should be measured in all patients with unexplained pulmonary hypertension. And this may lead to diagnosis of Graves' disease. Myocardial ischemia due to coronary spasm or associated coronary disease in these patients, and finally heart failure. And this heart failure is due to prolonged high output state that may cause cardiomyopathy. Initially, the cardiac output is high due to the disease status, but later on, with more affection of the and the cardiomyopathy, this will lead to decrease in the cardiac output. Another autoimmune disease with cardiac involvement, Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Hashimoto's thyroiditis is a disease result in destruction, presence of antibodies that lead to destruction of the thyroid gland and the gradual progressive thyroid failure. As we see, antibodies is specifically formed to thyroid peroxidase and thyroglobulin, development of inflammation, thyroid gland destroyed, patient ultimately rendered hypothyroid. This patient, if they developed manifestations of hypothyroidism, they may have sinus bradycardia. The blood pressure with mild to moderate hypothyroidism may develop hypertension, especially diastolic. With severe hypothyroidism, the blood pressure may be normal or low. But with mild and moderate, it may cause hypertension, especially diastolic. Pericardial effusion due to increased volume of distribution of albumin, which you may name it as dilutional hypoalbuminemia. This may lead to pericardial effusion due to decreased oncotic pressure of the plasma due to dilutional hypoalbuminemia due to increased volume distribution of albumin or decreased lymphatic clearance function. This may also cause pericardial effusion. Usually, the pericardial effusion is very gradual, rarely to cause tamponade, and it resolves with the thyroid hormone replacement. The atherosclerotic coronary and systemic vascular disease of hypothyroidism is very important due to hypertension, increased LDL level due to decreased LDL receptors, or it may be due to hyperhomocysteinemia. The serum CK level may increase, denoting skeletal muscle injury, and the ECG may show sinus bradycardia, low voltage due to pericardial effusion, and the prolonged QT due to bradycardia, which may be reduced to ventricular arrhythmias. Going to the scleroderma. The scleroderma has two different types, either localized scleroderma or systemic scleroderma. The localized scleroderma mainly include skin manifestations, morphea, linear scleroderma, what's called morphea, localized affection of the skin. This is called the localized scleroderma without any systemic manifestations, while the systemic scleroderma have skin manifestations and the systemic affection of different multiple organs of the body. And either of them, localized or systemic scleroderma, is further subdivided into types. Regarding the systemic scleroderma, which include multiple organs of the body, including the skin, it has different types: limited scleroderma, diffuse, and overlap syndrome. The limited scleroderma is called the crest syndrome. Why they are called limited scleroderma? Because it is limited to certain organs. While diffuse scleroderma include these organs and a lot of other organs, as the lung. It can cause interstitial lung disease. So we will name the systemic scleroderma, we will name the scleroderma that affect the lungs and have a different affections of the multiple organs is a diffuse scleroderma, while the scleroderma that is limited to these organs is called limited scleroderma. But both of them has a systemic affection. This is very important to understand the nomenclature of the scleroderma. The limited scleroderma, the CREST syndrome, include calcinosis of the skin, Raynaud's phenomena, esophageal dysfunction, sclerodactyly, and finally telangiectasia. This is the limited form of the systemic scleroderma. Regarding the myocardial affection of scleroderma, these patients usually have myocardial fibrosis, and the myocardial fibrosis is due to damage fibrosis around the small blood vessels and the progressive interstitial and the perivascular fibrosis that may lead to progressive myocardial ischemia and finally lead to myocardial dysfunction, either systolic or diastolic, over time. Fibrosis is usually patchy in the myocardium, affecting both ventricles, and it may cause systolic and diastolic dysfunction. Diastolic dysfunction may be related to pulmonary vascular congestion in the presence of normal ejection fraction, and the left ventricular hypertrophy may be present in the absence of systemic hypertension. Regarding the pericardial affection of scleroderma, pericarditis, pericardial effusion, is very common and require corticosteroid treatment. However, corticosteroids itself may induce renal crisis. What is renal crisis in scleroderma? Renal crisis is new onset accelerated hypertension or rapidly progressive oliguric renal failure during the course of systemic sclerosis, which is treated by corticosteroids. It will associated with the renal crisis, hypertensive episode, renal failure, LV failure, thrombocytopenia. Thrombocytopenia, renal failure, LV failure, and hypertensive episode. Renal crises are much more common in generalized disease than in limited disease. Generalized disease here is referred to the systemic scleroderma, which is the diffuse form. If we can modify this sentence, renal crises are much more common in the diffuse systemic disease rather than the limited scleroderma. Regarding the vascular affection, the pulmonary hypertension is very, very, very important complication of scleroderma. It happens in limited more than a generalized progressive systemic sclerosis. And it may be related to pulmonary vascular disease or secondary to interstitial lung disease. It has a two mechanism, either interstitial lung fibrosis that may cause pulmonary hypertension, which it's considered type 3 pulmonary hypertension, or it may be due to pulmonary vascular disease as a part of connective tissue disease, which is type 1 pulmonary hypertension. So the pulmonary hypertension in scleroderma can be in two types of pulmonary hypertension, either type 1 or type 3. The patient of scleroderma that develop pulmonary hypertension usually have significant morbidity and mortality with very bad prognosis. A 2-year survival in this patient is less than 50%. In addition to the pulmonary hypertension, the presence of myocardial ischemia and the MI may be with generalized disease due to coronary spasm, microvascular occlusion, and usually with normal epicardial coronaries with angina. And this is the electrocardiographic abnormalities that can happen in scleroderma from heart blocks, VM morphology, no change, and ventricular arrhythmias, left bundle branch block, grade 3 heart block. This is very nice illustration for the ECG changes that can happen for scleroderma patients. Going to the vasculitis section of the autoimmune disease that can affect the heart. Regarding the vasculitis, The vasculitis are classified according to the type of the vessel that the vasculitis disease can affect. They can be divided into large vessel vasculitis, medium vessel vasculitis, and small vessel vasculitis. The large vessel vasculitis includes the aorta and the big branches of the aorta, while the medium vessels include arterioles and arteries, like coronaries and their arterioles, while the small vessel disease include the capillaries, venules, and arterioles. And usually there is an overlap between these vasculitis, but many of the diseases have main affection, like giant cell arthritis and Takayasu arthritis are mainly affecting the aorta, but it can may affect the medium sized vessels vasculitis, but the main affection is the aorta and its main branches. So we have three different types of vasculitis: large vessel, medium vessel, small vessel. The large vessel, if it includes granuloma in patient more than 50 years, mostly it will be giant cell arthritis. If it is less than 50 years, it may be Takayasu arthritis. The medium-sized vasculitis, if it is associated with mucocutaneous lymph node, as we will see what is mucocutaneous lymph node, mostly it's Kawasaki. If it's not associated, mostly it is polyarthritis nodosa, a small vessel disease. If it is associated with paucity of vascular Ig, which is ANCA, any ANCA negative, maybe one of these diseases, vasculitis with no asthma or granuloma, it is microscopic polyangiitis. If it is associated with granuloma with no asthma, mostly it is granulomatosis with polyangiitis, which is called the Wegener syndrome. If it is associated with eosinophilia, asthma, and granuloma, usually it is Schirg-Strauss syndrome. If the small vessel vasculitis is associated with immune complexes, it may be systemic lupus or rheumatoid, it may be Henoch-Schönlein purpura, it may be cryoglobulinemic vasculitis, or it may be other types of vasculitis. So this is a very good illustration to the types of vasculitis and how can you differentiate between them. This is a very nice table in which we have here the different types of vasculitis, and here is the site of involvement and the inflammatory cell involved in the disease and other supporting features. For example, Schirg-Strauss syndrome usually affect small vessels and the medium vessels, but more in the small vessels. The lymphocyte, macrophage, neutrophils are involved in the inflammatory milieu of it, and usually is associated with granuloma, thrombosis, asthma, atopy, and so on. We will go in the different types of arthritis, starting from the Takayasu arthritis. Takayasu arthritis and idiopathic large and medium vessel vasculitis of young individuals. Median age 25, more in females than males. It is usually related to mononuclear cellular infiltration to reach the vessel wall through the vasa vasorum and subsequently migrate to the intima, causing these arthritis. It can cause four different features: arterial stenosis, aneurysm, coronary arthritis, and myocarditis. Regarding the arterial stenosis, is more common than an aneurysm. It most common site to affect arterial stenosis is subclavian and the innominate artery. It can result in claudication in upper limb more than a lower limb. Pulse and the blood pressure asymmetry between both sides. vascular Bruit, hypertension due to renal artery stenosis, or suprarenal aortic stenosis. Suprarenal aortic stenosis, it acts physiologically and functionally as bilateral renal artery stenosis. Blood pressure in one of both arms may underestimate central aortic pressure. Because if we have stenotic subclavian or laminate artery. So if we have different asymmetries between both limbs, we may have Takayasu arthritis. The aneurysms usually involve the aorta and the aortic root and may lead to aortic regurgitation. The coronary arthritis infrequently usually involves the austere regions. So these are the main four presentations of Takayasu arthritis. Either arterial stenosis by all its clinical implications, aneurysms, coronary arthritis, and myocarditis. The disease activity is denoted by increased extremity or visceral ischemia, malaise and myalgia and arthralgia, increased ESR, new vascular abnormality in sequential angio studies. If we do angio and find new lesions that was not present, new lesions that were not present in previous angio, this means that the activity of the disease is very high. May be detected by MRI or PET. However, there may be a still progressive disease despite normal ESR and absence of any constitutional or new vascular symptoms in many patients. So we should take care of this point. The diagnosis of the arthritis is based on the clinical feature in conjunction with the vascular imaging abnormalities, the aortogram or MRI, and the histopathological diagnosis that can support the diagnosis in patients that undergo vascular surgery. When patient is indicated for surgery for the aneurysm, repair of aneurysm, repair of stenosis, repair of different complications, we can take a biopsy from the vessel wall to further illustrate the diagnosis and further confirm the diagnosis. Going to the giant cell arthritis, which is called the temporal arthritis. This is a condition consists of granulomatous inflammation of the large and the medium-sized vessels. The most common vasculitis in patients more than 50, in contrast to a Takayasu. Takayasu is less than 50, giant cell more than 50, with a female predominance. And 30 to 50% of the patients have concurrent polymyalgia rheumatica. Polymyalgia rheumatica, the patient may have fatigue, easy fatigability. The pathogenesis of giant cell arthritis, it includes transmural vessel inflammation, with inflammation begin in the adventitia, where the vasa vasorum are conduit for mononuclear cells that mediate the vascular injury. Usually affect the extracranial branches of the aorta, sparing the intracranial vessels. The giant cell arthritis does not affect the intracranial vessels. And the vascular lesions usually reach in pro-inflammatory cytokines, intermediate lesions that harbor mediators of matrix destruction as in metalloproteinases that will lead to stimulate neointimal proliferation and the vessel stenosis. This matrix metalloproteinases may destruct the matrix, and this will induce growth factors that stimulate new intimal proliferation and cause vessel stenosis and aneurysm. The clinical picture include the following items: headache, atypical and severe, scalp and temporal arterial tenderness that may be associated with acute visual loss due to affection of the ophthalmic artery, bulge myalgia rheumatica, as we said, and mastication muscles muscular pain due to affection of the blood vessels that go to the mastication muscle. It may affect the aorta, causing aortitis, involve the aorta and its primary branches as a subclavian. Some patients may present with features resembling Takayasu and may cause thoracic and abdominal aortic aneurysm. these patients of the giant cell arthritis may present with myocardial infarct. How can we diagnose? The diagnosis can be made by the clinical features that we just said: headache, scalp temporal arterial tenderness, acute visual loss, polymyalgia rheumatica, mastication, and muscle pain. In the presence of high ESR, even without temporal artery biopsy, if it is the diagnosis may be doubtful if no dramatic improvement within 24 to 72 hours of steroid treatment. So the steroid treatment may be used as a diagnostic criteria when the patient with all these clinical pictures respond within 24 to 72 hours to the steroid treatment. So mostly the diagnosis is giant cell arthritis. The temporal artery biopsy is the gold standard to confirm the diagnosis. It may be helpful with atypical features. The positive yield is 50 to 80% because the arterial affection may be patchy. And the typical histological features include infiltration with giant cells, lymphocytes, plasma cells, intimal and subintimal inflammation, internal elastic lamina destruction, intimal hypertrophy. Going to Kawasaki disease. Kawasaki disease, one of the vasculitis diseases that affect the medium-sized vessel. The principal cause of the Kawasaki the Kawasaki disease is a principal cause of acquired heart disease in children in many countries, and usually affect children less than 5 years. More common in the Asian children. And the pathogenesis may present an abnormal immune response to undiscovered pathogen with molecular mimicry to normal host antigens. In its pathology, it includes either vasculitis with endothelial edema, necrosis, desquamation, leukocyte infiltration. And after months, this inflammatory reaction will resolve with myointimal proliferation that may produce stenosis or vascular wall weakening that may cause aneurysm and thrombosis. The clinical picture is very important. Every cardiologist should be aware of the clinical picture because he may face this fever more than 5 days without other explanation, plus at least 4 of these following items: bilateral painless conjunctival injection, or mucous membrane changes, injected or fissured lips, injected pharynx, or strawberry tongue is very characteristic. Extremity abnormality, any of the following: erythema of the palm and sole, edema of hand and the feet, like this. Generalized or peripheral desquamation of hand and feet. The presence of polymorphous rash, cervical lymphadenopathy. And this is called the mucocutaneous lymph node syndrome, which differentiates between Kawasaki disease and the polyarthritis nodosa. Polyarthritis nodosa have the same features, but without mucocutaneous affection. What is the cardiovascular affection or manifestation of Kawasaki disease? It may cause pericardial effusion, myocarditis with ventricular arrhythmia and heart failure, mitral regurgitation, aortic regurgitation. It may cause coronary aneurysm. It appears after 1 to 4 weeks after the fever onset, as we just said, due to the inflammation, usually in the proximal segments, in the coronary vessels, left main, proximal LAD, proximal LACX, and it appear by non-invasive techniques like an echo in 20% of patients compared to 60% by angio, and their course either the giant aneurysm rarely to regress, but the small aneurysm 50% will undergo angio regression within 1 to 2 years, or it may go for thrombotic coronary occlusion with myocardial infarction, most common in the first year after the illness, and even sudden cardiac death. In addition to the pericardial effusion, myocarditis, valvular affection, coronary aneurysms, we have coronary stenosis, which may be due to vascular remodeling process in the injured vessels, vasculitis, which may affect aorta, carotid, subclavian, celiac, mesenteric, pulmonary artery. And the illness is usually self-limited within 4 to 8 weeks. The mortality is less than 2%. Going to the Schirg-Strauss syndrome, which is one of the small vessel vasculitis that is characterized by eosinophilia, asthma, pulmonary infiltrates, upper airway inflammation. With variable frequency of the cardiac, renal, neurological, and cutaneous involvement. Lesions consists of eosinophilic granulomatous infiltration and vasculitis. And the pathogenesis include ANCA antibodies. ANCA for anti-neutrophilic cytoplasmic antibodies. We have two different types of ANCA antibodies, either B or C. C related to cytoplasmic. B related to perinuclear pattern. And to further illustrate what is meant by C and B, it describes the presence of the antibodies. Either it is cytoplasmic, free in the cytoplasm, or perinuclear, around the nucleus. The specific antigen targeted by the B ANCA is usually myeloperoxidase enzyme, and the C ANCA is the proteinase 3. So we have two different types of ANCA. This may tell the vasculitis disease, as we have some of the vasculitis which ANCA negative, so, and some with ANCA positive. Some of the ANCA positive have mainly B ANCA, and some have C ANCA. So it can, as we just said, with the systemic lupus, for the anti-nuclear antibodies, the form of ANCA antibody can further go with the diagnosis of one of the vasculitis disease. Here, this is the cytoplasmic ANCA C against the proteinase C. Usually it is present in the Wegener granulomatosis. The ANCA B, myeloperoxidase enzyme, against the myeloperoxidase enzyme, and it usually associated with Schirg-Strauss angioids. What is the cardiovascular manifestation of Schirg-Strauss? Usually, the cardiovascular disease occur in 15 to 55% of the cases. This is the most common cause of death in this patient. They may manifest by pericarditis, myocarditis, heart failure, coronary arteritis, mesenteric ischemia, which may involve the small intestine and the core. And as a recommendation of our lovely paper, the red flags and the cardiological diagnostic methods are identical to those with other systemic inflammatory disease. Heart involvement is typically associated with high eosinophilic count and the negative ANCA status. The diagnosis of myocarditis may reinforce the indication for immunosuppression. The polyarthritis nodosa is one of the medium-sized vasculitis without mucocutaneous lymph node syndrome, as the Kawasaki. The polyarthritis nodosa is a non-granulomatous disease of only medium-sized arteries. And it resembles a microscopic polyangiitis, but the microscopic polyangiitis in the small vessels and the polyarthritis nodosa in the medium vessels. The microscopic polyangiitis is a clinically similar condition, but involves the small vessels, the capillaries, venules, the arterioles. And the cases with glomerular nephritis, renal capillaritis, pulmonary infiltrates, alveolitis, or capillaritis would be considered microscopic polyangiitis, not polyarthritis nodosa. So, in conclusion of the definition, polyarthritis nodosa and the microscopic polyangiitis have the same pathology, but this the polyarthritis nodosa involves the medium-sized vessels, and the microscopic polyangiitis involves the vasculitis. The small vessel vasculitis. The epidemiology, it usually affects patients with a range of 40 to 60 years, and the pathogenesis include the vascular walls are infiltrated by neutrophils, later on mononuclear cells, necrotizing changes, vessel weakening, aneurysm formation, myointel proliferation, and causing stenosis and occlusion. Clinical picture, it may involve systemic symptoms in more than 50% of patients, musculoskeletal symptoms in more than 50% of cases, neuropathy, mononeuritis multiplex, painful skin nodules, similar to erythema nodosum, that may progress to skin infection and gangrene, as we see in this picture, renal infarction and failure, segmental pulmonary infarctions, the cardiac manifestations, which include angina, myocardial infarction, congestive heart failure, hypertension, pericarditis. Going to Behçet disease. Behçet disease is a multi-system inflammatory disorder of unknown etiology. It is diagnosed by recurrent ulcerative ulcerations, at least 3 episodes over 12 months, plus at least 2 of the following. If we have patient with recurrent oral ulceration, that happens at least 3 episodes per year, plus 2 of the following, so Behçet disease is diagnosed. 2 of what? Recurrent genital ulcers, eye lesions, recurrent genital ulcers, and eye lesions like uveitis, hypopion, and retinal vasculitis. Skin lesions, the erythema nodosum, pseudofolliculitis, and the acneiform nodules, and the positive Bethurgy test. What is positive Bethurgy test? A skin injury with a needle prick lead to babule or pustule formation within 48 hours. So this is a diagnostic criteria to Behçet. If you have recurrent oral ulceration 3 times within a year, plus 2 of the following: recurrent genital ulcers, eye lesions, skin lesions, positive Bethurgy test, so the diagnosis of Behçet disease is a combination. What is the cardiovascular manifestations of Behçet disease? The Behçet disease can cause vasculitis, and this may lead to thrombosis, usually venous thrombosis, usually superficial thrombophlebitis. In a small number of cases, the pulmonary arterial vasculitis may lead to incitopulmonary arterial thrombosis. So the venous and the pulmonary sides are both affected. It may cause pulmonary arterial aneurysm, which is life-threatening. Other cardiac manifestations, in less than 10% pericarditis, myocarditis, intracardiac thrombosis, myocardial infarction, and myocardial aneurysm, and cerebrovascular disease. After reviewing the autoimmune diseases and their manifestations, if we go to the treatment of most of these diseases, we will find that non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs will be an integral part in the management of these diseases. And as the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs have a drastic cardiovascular effects, every cardiologist should know what is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs and what is the cardiovascular affection, and which of them is better for the cardiovascular disease patient. First of all, regarding the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, we have 2 different types of non-steroidals, either selective COX-2 inhibitors or non-selective COX inhibitors. We have 2 different types of COX enzyme, cyclooxygenase enzyme, COX-1 or COX-2. COX-1 is present normally in the stomach kidney, intestine, platelets, endothelium. And it produced prostaglandin E2 or thromboxane or prostacyclin. Prostacyclin has a vasodilator effect. Thromboxane share in the thrombus formation and in the hemostasis. Prostaglandin E2 is very important and has a lot of physiological functions in the kidney and the intestine and the stomach, etc. While COX-2 is inducible and it is represented upon the appearance of inflammatory state by the macrophage and other inflammatory cells. COX-2 produce inflammatory prostaglandins, proteases, and reactive oxygen species, which will lead to inflammation. So the materials produced by COX-2, it's not present all the time, and it will lead to inflammation. While the materials produced by COX-1, it is physiological, it is present all the time, and it has different physiological functions in the different organs of the body. The non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, either we have selective COX-2 inhibitors or non-selective. The non-selective inhibit both cyclooxygenase enzyme, while selective inhibit only cyclooxygenase enzyme 2, which spares the cyclooxygenase 1, leading to continuation of the physiological actions of COX-1. One of the most important drastic effects of non-selective non-steroidal is that the non-selective non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs will affect the prostaglandins produced in the stomach, leading to predisposition to gastric ulcers and duodenal ulcers. While this side effect is not a side effect of of selective COX-2 inhibitors. So in general, the non-selective COX inhibitors, they have analgesic, antipyretic, anti-inflammatory, antiplatelets with effect on the kidney function. All non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, selective or non-selective, are associated with increased cardiovascular risk, which may be related to hypertension due to inhibition of the vasodilating prostaglandins, and may lead to thrombotic events because of the imbalance between thromboxane and the prostacyclin. There will be imbalance between thromboxane and the prostacyclin. Pre-existing heart failure exacerbation because of the sodium and the sodium and water retention by their action on the kidney, and the oxidative stress induced by cyclooxygenase 2 inhibitors, especially COX-2. Some non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, as in ibuprofen, may block the aspirin benefits because of the competitive inhibition at the acetylation site in the platelet COX-1 enzyme. So this is a drastic effects of the non-steroidals, especially in the either the non-selective or the COX-2 selective on the cardiovascular system. Regarding the non-selective COX inhibition, one of the most beneficial characteristics is low-dose aspirin is cardioprotective, as we all know. On the other hand, the non-selective non-steroidal anti-inflammatory inhibit COX-1 and COX-2. However, the selectivity varies and thus elevate the cardiovascular risk. If we see this diagram, we can see that when we go for the COX-2 selectivity, celecoxib as a prototype of this group, this may increase the risk of cardiovascular events and decrease the risk of GIT side effects as a beneficial effect. On the other hand, the aspirin, which is more non-selective COX inhibition, has a cardioprotective effect with increased risk of GIT side effects. It can may induce GIT bleeding. Ibuprofen and naproxen are the safest non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs regarding the cardiovascular effects. And other non-selective non-steroidal anti-malarial drugs also carry a risk of cardiovascular events. Going to the COX-2 inhibition, it has a gastroprotective effect, as we just said. Increase the cardiovascular risk due to thromboxane-mediated vasoconstriction and the platelet aggregation unbalanced with the prostaglandin inhibition. As we can see here, it will occlude the COX-2 inhibitor, but will lead to increased thromboxane A2, and it will be unbalanced with the prostaglandin, so this may induce thrombosis. The cardiovascular risk of COX-2 inhibitors: we have cardiovascular thrombotic events and MI and stroke. One of the prototypes of COX-2 inhibition inhibitors is the rofecoxib. Rofecoxib was compared to naproxen in randomized control trials, and it was withdrawn from the market because it increased the risk of myocardial infarction 5 times in compared to naproxen. So rofecoxib was stopped from the market and withdrawn from the market. Celecoxib is still used with caution, especially in high-risk patients, because FDA concluded that health benefits outweigh the potential risk of drug use, and the risk is high at 200 milligram per deciliter. So we can use celecoxib, but in a very limited and monitored fashion. Who of the patient of the cardiac patient at a high risk of cardiovascular events, patient with recent ACS, with CABG bypass, and the patient with history of cardiovascular events as a myocardial infarction, and patient with active atherosclerotic process. The risk of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory is that diclofenac has the highest risk of cardiovascular events, stroke, MI, mortality. Ibuprofen, the risk of cardiovascular events is comparable to celecoxib. It can be used especially in pericarditis cases. The naproxen is the safest preferred non-selective non-steroidal in patients with high risk of cardiovascular events. Meloxicam, the risk is not known. How to get, and this is the important question, how to get the best benefit with the least harm from these non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs? The HA recommends the lowest dose for the shorter amount of time to achieve symptomatic relief. The stepwise approach, as we will see in this slide. Patient given aspirin may be given non-steroidal despite the following concerns. Ibuprofen negates the cardiovascular effect of aspirin, and aspirin negates the gastroprotective effect of celecoxib. So, to decrease the cardiovascular events of the non-steroidals, we can give aspirin to give more protection for the heart. BBI may be required with continuation, with concomitant use of aspirin and non-steroidals, because the risk of GIT affection is very high, and the patient should be closely monitored for the blood pressure, signs of edema, renal function, GIT bleeding. This is two best benefit with the least harm from non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. What is the stepwise approach? The stepwise approach to get the maximum benefit from non-steroidal and have the least harm from them is to go with acetaminophen, aspirin, tramadol for a short term. If it's not available, or if it's not tolerated, we can go for non-COX-2 selective non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, which, as we have no COX-1 selective non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. We have either non-selective or COX-2 selective. So the COX-2 selective non-steroidal selective non-steroidals have the highest risk of cardiovascular events. So it is at the bottom of the list. So we should not use COX-2 selective non-steroidals unless there is no option other than that option. In between the aspirin and acetaminophen and tramadol, we can go for the non-selective, non-steroidal antifungal drugs with a high beneficial effect or less harm effect for the naproxen. The naproxen is one of the important non-steroidals with the least cardiovascular affection. So again, select the patient at a low risk for thrombotic events, prescribe low dose required to control symptoms, add aspirin and proton pump inhibitors to patients at increased risk of thrombotic events. Regular monitoring for the patient for hypertension, worsening of blood pressure, edema, renal function, GIT bleeding. And consider reduction of the dose or discontinuation of the offending drug and different drug or alternative therapeutic modalities as indicated by clinical circumstances. So this is the steps to get the best benefit from the non-steroidal with the least harm. Again, lowest dose with shorter duration. Stepwise approach, as we just said, first aspirin, acetaminophen, and tramadol, then non-selective COX inhibitors, especially naproxen, and finally COX 2 inhibitors. And we may give aspirin to the patient to decrease the cardiovascular events. BBI, close monitoring to the blood pressure, signs of edema, renal function, and GIT. The other anti-rheumatic medication that are usually used in the treatment of autoimmune disease and have cardiovascular affection include glucocorticoids, which may increase the blood pressure and worsen the lipid profile and the metabolic profile of the patient. Hydroxychloroquine, which may cause hypertension, cardiomyopathy, and may cause prolonged QT, predisposing to ventricular arrhythmias. Methotrexate, causing a hyperhomocysteinemia that may lead to acute coronary syndromes. Leflunomide, which is a disease-modifying drug, may lead to hypertension, hyperlipidemia. Cyclosporin, which is immunosuppressive drug, may cause hypertension and hyperlipidemia. So the cardiologist, when a cardiologist have a patient with autoimmune disease treated with cyclosporin and presenting with hypertension, he should talk to his rheumatologist and agree upon together for the other treatments that has less side effects other than cyclosporin. If the cyclosporin is the only drug that can be used, so the blood pressure can be controlled by other measures and other antihypertensive medications. Tumor necrosis factor alpha antagonists like infliximab and eternal recept may increase the mortality in class 3 and class 4 heart failure. So the cardiologist should be aware of the potential toxicity of other anti-rheumatic medications that are used in the autoimmune diseases. And finally, going to a general approach for to manage the patient with autoimmune disease who have cardiac manifestations. Myocardial involvement in systemic autoinflammatory diseases, diagnostic workup and management. We have a cardiac red flags, one or more in patient with known systemic inflammatory disorders, unexplained dyspnea, palpitation, chest pain with or without troponin release, syncope, arrhythmia, acute chronic heart failure, aborted sudden cardiac death, or fulminant unexplained cardiogenic shock. Should go for cardiological evaluation, history, examination, ECG, echo, troponin, BNP, CMR, PET-CT according to the situation, heart catheterization according to the disease and situation, and the serum cardiac autoantibodies. Exclude pericardial, valvular, coronary artery disease, extracardiac disease. A specific workup tailored according to case by case. No coronary artery disease, no known causes of cardiac red flags. Clinically suspected myocardial involvement as in myocarditis. Consider endomyocardial biopsy and search for infectious agents. And finally, multidisciplinary management at baseline and follow-up, including cardiologists and disease-specific therapists personalized and targeted to the lowest level of disease activity as, for example, treat-to-target strategy. The recommendations in general of the task force in this subject recommend the echocardiography in all patients with suspected cardiac involvement. CMR should be considered in uncertain cases or where myocarditis or myocardial infiltration is suspected, but if sarcoidosis is suspected, endomyocardial biopsy if it will affect the management drastically. Endomyocardial biopsy also may foster treatment decision on the basis of histopathological results. Use of biomarkers and natriuretic peptides according to the ESC heart failure guidelines. I'd like to take your attention that you should put on your mind that there is a very wide differential diagnosis of diseases with systemic presentation and the cardiac involvement. One of them is a systemic inflammatory disease, but it may include infections, may include toxins, medications, infiltrative or storage disease, hereditary disease, and other diseases. All these diseases can be presented by systemic manifestations. My take-home message that cardiovascular system affection of the autoimmune disease is common and they need continuous surveillance for early management and treatment. Cardiovascular morbidity is the most common cause of mortality in autoimmune disease, and cardiologists should be aware of the clinical manifestations and the management of autoimmune disease within a multidisciplinary team. Thank you for your attention, and I'd like to have any question on this email, and thank you for your attention.